This session is on taking your personal testimony as a Christian, but using it in a purposeful way to make the gospel presentation or make the truth of the gospel known to someone who doesn't know Christ. Okay, so this is focused on that. If you have a seat kind of between you and somebody else and you don't have it planned to be used, could you scooch in just so that the folks who come in here at the end have a way to get to a seat without climbing over you? That would be real helpful. We're real pleased at our conference. We maxed out capacity at our conference. We're basically sold out. But it's kind of hard to sell out when everything's free, but technically we sold out. But that just means all our breakout rooms are going to be a little bit like this. So it's a good problem to have, but you get to make a friend this way. You get to sit next to someone. Okay, come on in. We're going to start. Make your way on in. Let's do a quick prayer, and then I'll get right into the content of the program today. As I'm praying, just feel free to keep walking and come on in. Dear Father, I thank you, Lord, for our time this afternoon and for the room full of folks eager to hear and learn how to represent you better in this world. Father, I pray a blessing on our words today. I pray that my words would be edifying, Father. I pray that they would be according to your will. And I pray that as we share with one another the things we'll speak about here today, Father, that we'll always have you in the center of our heart and in the focus of our mind. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I'm really excited about this conference. I'm really excited about this topic for the breakout session. I don't think there's going to be any topic you're going to hear while you're in this session or in this conference that's more personal and more readily available to you for the purpose of reaching people in Christ. We don't have mics in here. I'm sorry. I'll speak up a little louder. I'm sorry. Some of the breakout rooms are small, so we're just going to expect speakers to make their voices heard. I'm apologizing. Keep in mind as well that we video everything, so if you catch something partially here, you can see it later. All right, so here's what we're going to do today. And this is a program that I've done in many places, many different places I've visited and traveled. I've had the chance to present this. And I always find it refreshing to have people think about their testimony in a new and purposeful way, because I know we've seen people do testimonies. I want you to think about it now as a tool and not just as something personal you share with someone because they're interested in you or vice versa. It's purposeful. So here's the program for what we're going to do today. First, let's look at the elements of a testimony. Let's look then at some example videos of people doing it that I think you're going to enjoy. And then the part you're all going to fear, audience participation. We're going to see if anybody in here is willing to help us out here toward the end. No one's going to be forced, don't worry. But we'll see if anybody's interested. All right, let's look at the elements of it. I want to take scripture as the starting point. I always try to. The scripture I'm going to point us to is one you probably know really well from 1 Peter. He says that we're always to be ready to do something. And he says specifically to make a defense, and that then to anyone who asks to give an account, for the hope that lies in you or that is in you. I want to start with the red words here and to focus. This is what we're trying to talk about, do when we talk about a testimony. We're trying to be ready. In order to be ready, what does that imply? Preparation. If you think that a testimony is an off-the-cuff speech about your life, then you're not thinking about it in a way that's going to make it useful to you. You're not giving it full consideration as a tool. You have to be prepared, which means you have to think about this in advance of any thought of using it, even before you know you need to do it, and it needs to be purposeful. Secondly, it's a defense. It's a defense. In other words, you are there to explain something to someone that they don't understand. It's a defense in the sense that you have to explain something that it doesn't make sense to them. What is it that doesn't make sense to them? Well, the hope that lies in us in a world that's falling apart, in a world that's full of all the horrible things you see on the news these days, and yet we as a Christian family have hope knowing that this world is not our final home. As I like to say, if you're a Christian, this is as bad as it gets. If you're an unbeliever, this is as good as it gets. So as a believer, you can look at the world with eyes that know, this stuff's passing, it doesn't bother me. Pretty soon I'm going to be home with the Lord and then in the kingdom, so I don't have to worry too much about this world. I'm not invested in it. That's a very strange perspective to an unbeliever. And they're going to ask you to defend that. How is it you can feel so hopeful in such a terrible fallen world? How come you have a different outlook? So our goal is to prepare, to make a defense, and to do so to answer a fundamental question about what do you have that I don't have? A testimony is one way to do that, not the only way. In fact, if you want to come to my next breakout session, which is following this one in the same room, we're going to go beyond just testimonies. We're going to talk about five other tools that you can use, ways you can go about sharing the gospel. It's an evangelist toolbox, I call it. So I'm not advocating for mine over others. I'm just telling you that's what I'm doing. All right. So we're talking now about a particular tool, your personal testimony. I want to be very clear about what I mean when I say personal testimony. You've no doubt heard somebody stand up perhaps at church and give a testimony? How many of you have never seen that happen, never seen a Christian give their testimony? Anybody? Okay, so we all kind of know what we're looking at. May I suggest, though, you may not have seen it done in the way that I'm going to suggest it should be done if your goal is to reach someone with Christ. Now, I know the heart is probably always to reach someone, but that doesn't mean you're going to have the right approach unless you make it purposeful. This is about how you make your testimony purposeful. Let's start by talking about what is the story of your faith transformed into a tool. Let's start with another scripture. I love this one out of Colossians on the topic of personal testimony. Look what he says. He says, conduct yourselves with wisdom toward outsiders, making the most of the opportunity. Let your speech always be with grace as though seasoned with salt, so that you will know how you should respond to each person. What I love about this, most of all, is that Paul acknowledges that there are different methods for different people under different circumstances. If you've ever imagined your role as an evangelist to be simply the kind of one tool for every job, you know the old saying that if all you have is a hammer, everything looks like a nail? Because you just imagine, I'm only going to have one tool, I might as well use it for everything. But friends, that's not biblically correct. This scripture would tell you that's actually unbiblical to do that. You have to have wisdom to look at everybody differently and understand some people need a certain technique. That's something I'll cover more in the next breakout session. That is, we'll go through all these different techniques and we'll say, what is this appropriate for? Who is it not appropriate for? And sort of show you how there's a wider array of things you can be doing. But for this particular one, what is a testimony then best for? When would you best find this to be the tool you pull out of your toolbox? Well, let me suggest a few things. First of all, if you have somebody who needs hope or needs empathy in the midst of some kind of situation, maybe situations you yourself have faced, what better opportunity than to say, hey, you know, I was there once. I had that happen. A child dies, a parent dies of cancer, you lose your job. You know, things that are, not everyone has exactly the same set of background or circumstances, but, you know, you're going to run into that person sooner or later who has your situation. There's your opportunity. That's not to simply say to them, oh yeah, I went through that too, don't worry, you'll get over it. That's not helpful, right? That's dismissive. What's helpful is to say, can I tell you a little story about myself? Because I have something you might want to hear. I've been where you are. And then you go through something very specific. That's not ultimately going to be about your history of that situation. It's ultimately about something bigger. But they're interested because it's touching on something they know is true for them. You're not unconcerned with them. It's not like this is a ploy, but you are purposeful in moving to something of a bigger conversation at the same time. So this is good for people who have similar backgrounds to you or similar circumstances. Or let's say you're dealing with someone who just has very little or no experience with Christianity, and they understand you're a Christian, and they're just fascinated. What is Christianity all about? Why do you follow Jesus? What is this all about? Well, I'm glad you asked. Okay, then you get into your testimony. Or thirdly, and this is a broad category, casual moments when any of the other methods might be too formal. And again, this doesn't make a lot of sense to us because we haven't gone through those other methods in this room yet. But if you look at some of the other ways people present the gospel with very formal, like a Bible track, or some of these very structured methods of walking people through the gospel, that you know and I know there's moments when that just doesn't work. You're dealing with someone who, that's a little too much, you know, and it's a little formal, a little weird, a little awkward. I just want to have coffee. Can we just have coffee, you know? Don't evangelize me. Let's just have coffee. Well, you can still evangelize them. You can just do it in a way that they don't feel that it's evangelizing them. And the testimony is often the best way to get over those moments because it's just a very personal story, or so it seems, right? So this is the one you put in your toolbox for those kinds of casual moments. All right, so what is a personal testimony? Well, it's a faith story, but I'm going to give you three points. I'm going to keep it really simple. I trust me, you'll remember these, and these will absolutely transform your testimony if you already have developed one, okay? First, it's a story about, anybody want to guess?
Jesus.
Oops, sorry, I hit the wrong button. It's about Jesus. This is the first, and I would argue, the most important way in which our testimonies go wrong. If you think it's a story about you, you've completely missed the point. It's not about you. It's about Jesus. And I mean that not just because of the fact that Jesus is obviously the one who brought you to faith. It's all about him in that sense, yes. But in the more than that, it's about why you're even giving your testimony. Why are you giving your testimony? To introduce someone to Jesus, not to get them feeling good about you, right? Or have them sort of, you know, shed a tear. And I mean, it's not about a performance. It's about him. So how many times have you heard a testimony in which you're like, I don't think that was about Jesus. They pretty much just talked about themselves the whole time, right? I'm going to show you some examples in video form here in a minute. I'm going to have you critique them for me, okay? But it's about Jesus, fundamentally. Secondly, I had a couple of backup bullets. It's not about you. You're simply the beneficiary, right? Make your goal getting out of the way so Jesus shines through in your testimony. Now, this is fundamentally, this is about pushing pride out of the way and letting Christ come forward, being humble, letting him take the spotlight, not you. And I think we've all seen that person who, God bless them and we love them to death, but they love to be in the spotlight. And you give them a mic and a pulpit and 10 minutes or 20 minutes, and, you know, Lord help us. We're just going to hear about this person's life. And it just wanders and rambles and wanders and rambles, and it's only about them. And they're just so happy that you're there to listen to them. And again, we love them, but that's not a testimony. It's not purposeful. It's not serving the purpose of the kingdom. We need to think very carefully about whether our pride is getting in the way. Okay? And it's true for all of us. By the way, none of us are exempt from this, right? We all have a tendency to sort of start talking about ourselves sometimes. We want to make sure this is about Jesus. Finally, as John the Baptist said, he must increase, but I must decrease. Okay? In other words, you cannot increase along with him. It's a zero-sum game. If you're increasing, he's decreasing. If you're decreasing, he's increasing in the sense of attention. Okay? So it's about Jesus. Second one, it's about transformation. This is a story of a beginning and an end, of a before and an after. Okay? Your testimony is a story of movement. It's not a story of where you are now. It's a story of how you got to where you are now as a Christian. It doesn't work as a tool if you don't start where the person is that you're talking to. If you're talking to an unbeliever, where are they in this movement story? They're still on the other side of the line, right? They're still waiting to move to Jesus. They haven't moved yet. So your story, if it's going to make any sense to them, if they're going to identify with it at all, then you have to start the story where they are, which means going back to before you knew Jesus. So it's a story of movement. I want to use a simple analogy or picture for you. I want you to imagine a seesaw where it can go up and down on both sides, right? We all used to do this as a kid, right? So it's a story of movement, like the movement of this seesaw. And at the center of this movement, what is at the center of the movement? What's the pivot point? What's the fulcrum that took you from one side to the other? It's the moment you're saved, right? It's the salvation moment. The salvation moment is the center of your story. I was at a VBS. I was in my mother's bedroom when she told me the gospel. I was a friend at a coffee shop. It was in the foxhole. I mean, I don't know how it happened to you, but somewhere along in your life it happened. Maybe as a child even, which makes this a little more challenging. We can talk about that at the end. But even still, there's a moment. Or at least there was a feeling of change. You want to make sure you're pivoting on that moment in your story. It's not the beginning of your story. It's not the end of your story. It's the pivot of your story. What do you find on either side of that story? From bad to good. And I'm using that very generically. I'm not saying your life was bad. You might have been a pretty nice person and then you came to faith. You might have been a bank robber and you came to faith. But bad has to speak less to the behaviors of your life or even the consequences and more to the heart of your life, to who you were. And I got to tell you, we all know this is true. If you don't want to admit it, I'm not going to make you admit it. But we all know this is true. Before you came to faith, you were a rotten person. And the day after you came to faith, you were still a rotten person. But you were starting to get better. By Christ's work in your heart, you were starting to get convicted of who you were. And you were starting to think differently about what you thought and what you did. And it started to matter more to you. And that's the transition we're going to start talking about. At the center, that's Christ. But on each end, you have this good to bad progression. Okay? So you're going to talk about from going from down to up, if you will. Now, by the way, I should add at this point, you're not making stuff up. Don't make up a funny story or a tearjerker. I mean, if you don't have all of these elements, then you have to think more carefully about what you do have. But do not lie. I mean, you know, this is not the point. Don't make stuff up just to have a great story. I hope I'm not misleading you to think that. All right, now the last one is the most important. I say that somewhat facetiously because obviously number one is probably the most important. But I think this is the most important in terms of how effective your story is going to be. It's the distinguishing feature between a good story and a bad story in many cases. Anybody know what it is? It's about
time.
3 minutes. All right? I say that. I mean, you want to make it four, you might two. Okay, but it's about 3 minutes. Here's why. And how many of you have heard a testimony that just would not end? Okay? How did you feel about that testimony? You felt good in the beginning. You started to get worried at a certain point, and they lost you at some point. Right? Friends, let's be honest. Modern society has a very short attention span. Okay? All right, modern society does not put up with, and I'm not saying that that's to their credit, I'm just saying that's what we're dealing with. And yeah, I think even if it weren't modern, I think it was always the case that we get tired of hearing people talk about themselves after a while, right? So we got to take that into account. Therefore, long testimonies will cause minds to wander, lose focus, and miss the point. Keep in mind, if this is a tool and you're using it purposefully to bring someone to know the gospel and that's your aim, then it's against your own best interests to make it boring, to make it last too long. And I got to tell you, friends, no one's as interested in your story as you are. So you will, if you think the longer you talk, the more interesting it gets, you ask someone who will tell you the truth. They'll tell you that, you know, I could have made it a little shorter. So keeping it short is actually beneficial if your purpose is reaching someone for Christ. And here's the last point. In my experience, general rule of thumb, the longer it goes, the less it is about Christ, the more it is about them. So later when we do the audience participation piece, I'm going to have my phone on timer, and I'm going to put on 3 minutes. And if I'd love to have someone, I'm hoping I'm not dissuading anyone by saying this, but I hope somebody will come up and take me on with this. So we want to do this in such a way that the goal is not chit-chat, the goal is saving lives, or saving souls, okay? All right. Now I'm going to give you 3 videos. These are taken off YouTube. You may even recognize at least one of the people, maybe 2 of them. I'm not here to critique them personally. I want you to pretend like they're nameless, faceless people. We're not here to judge them. What we're here to do is look at their method, okay? Does that make sense? Everybody understand that? I didn't put their names on here because it doesn't matter. It's just 3 people. I want you to grade them for me, and I want you, by grade, I don't mean like A, B, C, D. I mean, in light of the things we just listed, give me specific feedback on what they did good or didn't do good or well. Is there an English teacher in the room? What they did well or didn't do well compared to what we said is the ideal. All right? Let's do the first one. The sound will come out from over here. It stopped syncing on that. Hold on. Sorry. If the machine sleeps, it loses this. It only takes a second to get it back.
Battery 100%.
Okay. Ready? See if this plays. Is it playing? No, it's not playing. Oh, it's too far. Hold on.
What? I was raised in a Christian home.
Okay, sorry. We're going to start that again so you get the full speech. Sorry. It just didn't have a good connection.
First, could you tell us a little bit about your personal testimony of how you came to accept Christ?
Well, I tell you what, that turns into a long testimony, so I'll just kind of give it to you real quickly. I was raised in a Christian home. My mom and dad both were spirit-filled, okay, born again. At a very young age, I started doing drugs. I started doing drugs at 11 years old. I think the same reason most people get involved in drugs and alcohol, for some reason, we think it's going to make us look cool. It's going to make us look older. We want to fit in school. I started doing them very young. Started experimenting with pills and alcohol at 12, 13 years old, 14 years old, even more drugs. 15 years old, I didn't care how cool I looked. I had a really bad drug addiction, putting a needle in my arm every day. Started selling drugs. It just kept escalating and escalating until I was up in my 20s. I got in a bad bar fight. Turned out to be a shootout. Almost got killed that night, and on the way home, I said, I'm done living this life. Something I tell everyone with a drug addiction. It's up to you to say, no, I'm walking away from that. You know, so many times we want to go to rehabs, AA. I mean, all those places are good. I believe in rehabs and everything, but bottom line, you can go to rehab for years, and unless you make up your own mind, I'm done, you're still going to be going back to it. I said on the way home, I'm done. I went home. I told my wife, I said, we're moving. We moved over 1,000 miles away. And next thing I know, my wife starts going to church. 2 years after that, I followed her, went into the church, and ended up giving my life to Christ.
Okay. It was all of these are 3 minutes, by the way. So, observations? Yes, sir.
About him and less about Christ.
Yeah, Christ showed up at the very end. He made a cameo at the end. I'm not, by the way, I'm not delegitimizing his faith. Don't get, none of these, I believe all three of these people are Christians. What I'm saying is, in terms of the method they use, right? So as a method, we can say it was I, me. Pay attention next time you hear people do testimonies, how often that is their pattern. Again, I'm not making fun of them or anything. I'm just saying they're thinking the story's about them. No one's ever explained, perhaps, that it's really about Christ. All right? And I could ask you how you might have rephrased all these things to talk about Jesus, and you know, we could pretend one way or the other, but I don't want to go through the time of that. All right? So first thing, it wasn't about Jesus. What? Not fundamentally. What else?
Well, there was transformation in his mm-hmm. life. But it was at the very end, and it was very little.
Well, all right, so you raised a good point. Yeah, you raised a really good point, transformation. But if you were the unbeliever listening to this and you're thinking, man, I'm a drug addict too, what would you think the solution is?
It was his decision. Yeah.
Right, so you've got the power within you. Now, I'm not disputing what he said about getting out of addiction either. It's not the point. The point is we're talking about how to get out of hell. Whole different problem, right? So anyway, that's the other problem. It's about transformation, but he wasn't talking about the right transformation. He was talking about a physical, earthly transformation more so. Now, he did add, as you said, at the end, a little, well, obviously, he got to it at the very end, but not the focus of it. What else? Anything else that kind of popped out about it? It was the right length of time, but...
He doesn't want to say anything about after he accepted Christ.
Yeah. What were you going to say with the sim thing? Or?
You don't know what Christ did for him at all.
Right. Okay. So similar ideas here where it was like the seesaw. You heard 98% about the bad side, and at the very end, you saw the seesaw moving, and that was it. But you never really felt like there was the other side of the story. Remember, the pivot is the moment of salvation, and if you want to think of it in simple terms, a minute and a half before and a minute and a half after would be an ideal way to split it. Not the only way, but if I'm starting to make it sound so mechanical that it doesn't feel like it's you anymore, you're not thinking openly enough about what we're saying. We're saying you have a story, but you can tell your story a million ways. There's not just one way to tell your life, right? You have a million ways you could tell your story. We're saying be purposeful and use it in a way that's going to be the most likely to cause that person you're talking to ask a more fundamental question at the end. Like, man, you're saying that's all about Christ then, right? Yeah, so if I just believe in Christ, you tell me, yeah, let's talk more about what you need to do. Because at the end of this, you want to be prepared to talk about what comes next. But you've got to bring him into that conversation. And we all know God, the Lord is the one who does the movement, not you. You know, you're not saving anyone. But by that same token, we also know that the Lord has chosen purposely to work through the body of Christ as ambassadors to move that message out. So at the same time, we can say God's in control and he's using us. You know, one doesn't deny the other. So we have to be purposeful. All right, that's enough for that guy. You see the point, though. This is a guy who wanted to do his best to explain how he came to be where he is, but he got really trapped in his past as opposed to talking enough about what Christ did. Yes, ma'am.
Did he know this was supposed to be 3 minutes?
No. I went through, to show you how I found these, I went through YouTube. There's a lot of testimonies on YouTube. And I sorted by time, and I only looked at those that were 3 minutes or less. Do you know that's hard to find? Most of them are 20 minutes, 40 minutes. I mean, it's basically someone who had a whole Sunday morning to preach, and it was all about their testimony. Okay, that's fine. I'm not talking about scenarios in which you're in front of a crowd. I'm talking about scenarios in which it's one-on-one, and you're on a plane ride next to someone. You're standing at the bus stop next to someone. You're in line for the tickets for the movie, and it's a long line, and you got 3 minutes. I mean, I know you don't typically think of those moments as evangelistic opportunities, but maybe that's the problem. Those are moments. And they don't have to be like, oh, I got my Bible track with me. Here, let's whip it out. It can be more like, oh, I know this guy casually. Hey, I haven't seen you in a while. How you been? And all of a sudden, there's a turn in the conversation, and you can talk about your testimony. You know, you might be shocked how often it works if you only used it more often. You know, right? All right, so that's first one. Good comments. Let's do the second one. Like I said, you might recognize these people, but we're not here to talk about them.
I grew up in a very small town, okay? It's about 2,000 people. In my whole town, I think my school is 40 people. And there was this little Southern gospel. This is in Texas. There was a Southern gospel group that was coming through a friend of ours' church. There was about four or five churches in the town. They were coming through, so my dad loved music. And there was always music in the house. And so he said, let's go hear this band, this group. And so I remember being on the front row. I can still remember it in this little church. And this group is singing, and they give an invitation, like a time of like responding to God. I remember being 9 years old and responding to the gospel. And it was like my whole body just caught on fire. I wanted to make a decision. I wanted to make a decision for Jesus. That's where I want to stake my life. And that's what I knew. And that's really all you need to know. But like looking back, you realize that was the Holy Spirit of God, you know, like really reaching in and calling you, choosing you. And I love how the scripture says you don't choose God, but God chooses you. And I remember getting to junior high, just a few years after that, getting to junior high, and I'm at this youth camp and they're playing these worship songs. And I'm just like, what, this is amazing. There was something in it was stirring in me so strongly. I'm not making this up. I ran out of the back of the room. But in the middle of this time, I just ran out of the back of this auditorium and I just ran out. There was this kind of field and I found this tree and I just got knelt under this tree and said, Lord, I remember saying this. I said, Lord, I'm an eighth grader and you're the creator of the world. I have no idea what to say to you, but I know you're speaking to me. And I just want to say that whatever you want me to do for the rest of my life, I want to follow you. And say, Lord, I just want to have an available heart to you right now, right where I am, just to be available to be who you want me to be and wherever you want me to go.
And it's a little trickier now. Give me some feedback. Better than the first one?
Yes.
Okay, so. Yeah, this is a little worse. So think about what the content of it was. Where did it focus? Was it more about Jesus than about him? I'd say fairly. I mean, he mentioned that from his... Go ahead. I shouldn't answer my own question, sorry.
I agree with you. I think it was more about God. It was all about the Holy Spirit, not about anything that he did to merit that. It was his response.
He's focused a lot on his response.
There wasn't a whole lot of change.
All right. So in my analogy... Great. So in my analogy of the seesaw, where was the focus? Right on the pivot, in the middle, somebody said. It's right on the pivot. Now, it's hard to go wrong focusing on Jesus. I'm not saying that's bad, but it's not transformation. He kind of acted like he jumped right to the moment of an eighth grader needing, you know, kind of feeling God stirring in him, which is great. And then the second half was a lot of how he responded to the stirring in him. But there wasn't a whole lot of who I was and who Christ has made me. It was more of the Christ coming to me moment. That's pivotal. That's why we call it the pivot. But it narrows the focus so much that here's the reason that can be a problem. It makes it harder for the other person to identify with the story. Because remember, they don't have that experience. They have the before. You've had the pivot and the after. So you have to identify with them in the before so that then you can carry them forward through the rest of the story now with them thinking about them in your place. That's really the whole point of a testimony is I stand where you are at the beginning of my story so that we feel like we understand each other. Then I walk somewhere you haven't gone yet, and you walk with me in the story. What Chris, I don't want to mention his name. What this gentleman did was he put you right at the moment of the conversion, which was very personal for him and obviously very meaningful. But if you're not already in that mindset, you're not already a foot sort of toward Jesus in your life, if you're not already thinking about him, it just sounds like another Christian talking about being Christian. It doesn't talk about you. So the danger of this one is the opposite. The first guy talked a lot about the before. This person's kind of moved past that too quickly.
Yeah. He also mentioned that God chose him.
Right.
And so trying to equate the experience, you know, what if...
Yeah, that's a great point.
Have that experience, so God's not putting me on fire. What is that? Where does that...
That's a great point. So doctrinally, theologically, he's fine. But experientially, you don't go to the unbeliever preaching on the fact that God chooses you because it takes them out of the picture in a way that they don't understand. This is a teaching of doctrine for the believer. It's sort of like saying to the believer, you're a believer now, and you may not understand how you got here. Let me explain to you how it actually happened. But coming into the relationship as an unbeliever, that's way outside their ability to grasp. You need to take it back to them because that's how the gospel is preached, right? Repent and believe. The gospel isn't wonder if you're elected. The gospel is repent and believe, you know, and then after you're in the faith, we'll talk about what God must have done to bring you here. But that's a good point. I don't think he meant it that way. He was just sort of making sure we knew he didn't do it himself. But that is a good observation. We want to really focus it on their behavior. Yeah.
You know, and I think that from an unbeliever standpoint, when they don't know, I mean, I don't even know how to pray.
Right.
I love the fact that he said, you know, I'm a fifth grader.
There's some great elements to his testimony, and that's worth acknowledging too. There's some great elements, very very simple, very humble, not trying to oversell how he got his way in, all that. Just because it was so focused on the pivot, though, you might not find a lot to identify in it. I mean, take the two people we've watched. Imagine the second guy giving his testimony to the first guy, before the first guy was a believer, when he was a drug addict. I don't see the two connecting in that conversation, and that's my point.
So, Stephen, you know, I think one way that he could possibly change his story is at the end, say, talk about how God is sovereign, because that's what he did. He talked about the sovereignty of God. But then kind of relate that to the individual by saying how he's sovereign in this situation as well and in the interaction that I'm having.
Right. He could try to make it broaden the conversation. In fact, that's a good segue to the next thing I want to say about this. This guy's a good example of a testimony of a child. Not that he is a child, but that his testimony is of a childhood conversion. And that's often the first question I'll get on this topic is, what about me? I was saved when I was six. I didn't have my before is pretty short. I don't even remember my before. I don't even remember not being a believer. How many of you have that testimony? Yeah, so that's a blessing. That's awesome. Now it makes this a little more challenging. Here's what I would suggest you do, and he could have done this too. The pivot point moves a little in this sense. Instead of a pivot on salvation, the pivot becomes on sanctification. And by that I mean this. You're still preaching to someone who needs to know salvation, so you still make that their goal. But what you're going to tell them about is how being a Christian has transformed your life. From selfishness, sin, anger, depression, whatever it is that marked your early days as a Christian, but in the walk of faith, you've matured and you've seen Christ moving in your heart through the Spirit to do things in your life. It's now a transformation sort of post-salvation. It's not quite as effective, but it's better than nothing. And if you have a testimony of a 2-year-old, 5-year-old, 6-year-old conversion, well, that's not going to be an effective before and after anyway, so you might as well move it forward in time. And so now, again, you're commiserating with someone, you're empathizing with someone, they've gone through a bad situation, a divorce or whatever, and you can say, look, you know, I was in a real bad situation myself, but because of Christ working in me, here's what he did for me. And now you're not so much pivoting it on the moment of salvation, you're pivoting it on God's sanctifying work in your heart. And I've seen that be very effective as well, okay? Here again, there's no rules here. It's whatever works to make an effective presentation of the gospel, okay? All right, last one. You can tell we're getting better, so you should expect the next one to be better. I could never find one where I thought, oh my goodness, that one was like textbook, okay? It's hard to find, right? But this one's pretty good. So tell me what you think about this young lady. She is actually a younger lady, but she's not talking about a childhood conversion, so she's got a pretty good before and after.
I kind of knew who God was. You know, I've heard about him, but I didn't really have a personal relationship with him. As I began high school, I didn't really have a group of friends that accepted me for me. And so that's when I began to turn to drugs and alcohol as a replacement, trying to find those friends who really accepted me. And so I created a whole new person that I knew I wasn't, and I was sad, angry, depressed a lot of the times, and I used drugs and alcohol to escape that. Through that, I became very unhealthy. My lifestyle was just, it wasn't who I was brought up to be. I was partying every weekend and using drugs and alcohol to find my group of friends. And there was a point where I realized that I had become so self-destructive, and I was using drugs and alcohol to mask the reality, mask all my issues that I was going through, and to get away from the problems I had in my life. I created my own darkness, and the lifestyle that I was living was hurting myself. There was a point that I really just knew that it needed to end, and because I knew I couldn't control what was going on in my life anymore. And one night, I was invited by a good friend to U-turn, and I thought, okay, I guess I'll go, you know, we'll see. I know a couple people there, see what happens. And as soon as I walked through the doors, I was embraced by arms of people that I had no idea who they were. I was loved and cherished and just accepted exactly for who I was and exactly for what I was wearing, how I was dressed, and everything like that. Everyone just loved on me. And it was something that I never experienced before. I was never just accepted for exactly who I was to complete strangers. I started to go to U-turn often, but I still kept partying. And so living this double life was not something that I wanted to live, because I felt still being accepted by my partier friends that I was doing drugs and alcohol with, yet I was being loved on and cared about, like, for real with my church friends. And so in November of my sophomore year, I gave my heart to the Lord, and after that, I had this whole new sense of life. The darkness that I had created for myself, and the anger and depression and sadness that I had created, was gone. I had felt like a whole weight had just been lifted off my shoulders, and that everything that I've been worrying about and that I've made me that was making me angry and sad and depressed was just gone. Everything was lifted, and I felt like a whole new person. And I got that second chance. I felt totally redeemed, and that God just gave me that second life. It is incredible that God can just give you that second chance. God can bring you out of the darkness that you created for yourself. And I never thought that I would be here and who I am today. So it's incredible, and God is amazing.
All right, so what do you think?
Much better.
You see the, did you feel the pivot in the middle of it, right? Very clearly so. What kind of critique would you make, though? Right at 3 minutes. It was just, I mean, if, I think it was like, I did plus or minus, you know, 10 seconds or 20 seconds, but it's right around 3 minutes. Maybe 310, 320. Maybe, I mean, keep in mind that's a rough number in any case, but here's the thing. If you start feeling like I wish it was over, then that person's gone on a little long. But not so long as they lost you through it, you know. Any critiques?
My issue was she misused the phrase drugs and alcohol 10 times.
Yeah, so it's a...
And so that got real boring.
Yeah, so there's an example where if she was getting feedback, you'd say, you made the point, you know.
Drugs and alcohol, so that's...
And, you know, maybe just keep moving with the story, yeah. Yeah.
But she did use the term, created her own darkness.
Darkness, yeah.
Three times at least. And for me, that just really resonates perhaps with someone who creates this misery of a life that you're probably feeling.
Right.
And you can relate to that.
Yeah, so now go back to what I said a moment ago. Imagine her giving this testimony to the first guy. Mm-hmm. They'd click. At least they had the potential.
Yeah. She had,
right?
At the end, she was just really joyful.
Excited.
And if she could have said just a couple more sentences where she said, and now I do this, and it, and I can hug on other people.
Mm-hmm.
Sort of or something,
continuing
know,
the chain.
Yeah,
whatever is real for you in terms of how it's changed
she
your life. The only thing I would critique her on is she never said the word Jesus.
Yeah.
Now, she said God, and we all know what she's talking about, but the point is there's the identity of Christ is core to the gospel, so if you're not willing to mention Jesus to someone, and I don't mean that she didn't want to, I just don't think she thought about it, but you know, being very specific about, because what if they're thinking God like Allah?
Yeah.
Right? Getting a specific enough to the true God is important. But apart from that, I mean, we're nitpicking, obviously, but I think that's a good example. Now, having done all that, I'm going to do the review first, and then we're going to see if there's anybody in here that wants to help us out a little bit. And I'll start. I'll be the first audience participation member. Do I count?
Yes.
Okay. So, use your testimony to introduce someone to Jesus through a simple, approachable story. Okay? Back to what 1 Peter said. You're going to have to work this out beforehand, right? And I think it's kind of fun, actually, if you think about it. And if you have a spouse or sister, brother's friend, whatever, do it with them. Ask them to help you. Ask them to do theirs. And, you know, be purposeful about it. I think part of what we're going to address over the rest of this weekend is the motivation to do these things, the importance of doing these things, getting over some of the fear and other things that stop us. But that doesn't, by itself, equip you. So you have to be equipped. Also, you have to have the motivation to do it. This is the equipping side of it. So you have to sit and work on it, practice, a little homework. Secondly, keep it focused on the work Jesus did to transform you and keep it short. And then, and I haven't mentioned much about this so far, but you know, you ever heard about the joke about the dog that chases the car, but then once he caught it, he didn't know what to do with it? You know, there's almost this sense of, I'm going to prepare, but of course, it's never going to work. I mean, you're not saying that to yourself, but you're surprised if it does. Like if you give your testimony and the person suddenly has this strong interest in knowing more about Jesus, you're like, I got to get you to my pastor. You know, you did everything. It's sort of like you hooked him, and then once you got a hook, you're like, here, somebody take my rope. I can't bring this guy in. So you have to be thinking about this as well, not only from how do you present, but also what would happen if the person said, man, I really wish I had what you have. Like the drugs and alcohol comparison again between the first guy and the last gal. Man, what if it was before he came to faith, right? So he's still in the midst of all of those drugs and people shooting at him or whatever else he said was going on. And somehow this gal gives him the story and he starts crying. You know, imagine the scenario like that. It starts crying and says, I just wish I had what you had. I didn't know this was going to happen. Now what? Steve didn't tell me about this one. So you have to be thinking about, maybe you say at that point, well, can I pray with you? Or can I, are you ready to accept Jesus? Do you feel him tugging on your heart? I mean, you know you're like a step away at that point. You know, just be ashamed not to take the next step. So be thinking about that. And then be ready to approach. Okay, so what we're going to do now, if you'd like to do it with me, is I'm going to give my 3-minute testimony. And you're going to say, oh, it's easy for you. You've practiced it. The truth is, no, I haven't. I've never given it the same way twice. So I don't mean you can't practice it. I'm just telling you I haven't rigged the game here. So, in fact, I'm just going to use a stopwatch so y'all can see the count with me, okay? So this one doesn't go sideways anyway. So here's the count, okay? But I'm not going to show it to you while I'm talking because you won't look at me. All right. So I grew up in a home of people that were good, decent people. My dad was an attorney. My mom was a homemaker. A good family. I had brothers, sisters, you know, really that kind of family everybody looks at and says, well, you just seem to have your whole life together. And we did from the outside for the most part. I grew up, went to school, went to an all-boys Catholic high school. Did various school programs and had a good successful career in high school, and then went off into the Air Force Academy and had 4 years in the Air Force Academy, came out an Air Force officer, spent 9 years active duty. I mean, had it all. What I didn't know, though, was that all the things that I hated about myself were things that were really about who I was inside, not about my life. I would often say, I don't like being in the military. I don't like this situation or that situation, where I live, what I did. And I was never happy. I used to chase after everything. I enrolled in med school for a while. That didn't work out. I started teaching in community college. That didn't work out. Felt like whatever I was doing, I found no satisfaction in, and there was always something else I was wanting to do. Meanwhile, my poor wife at home, who I married when I was 22, was basically abandoned because I was too busy trying to find satisfaction in life. And then at a point in time in my late 20s, as I was in the Air Force, my wife patiently just began realizing she had married an unbeliever. And she was a believer and thought she'd married a believer because I told her I was, because, you know, that's what let me get married. She just didn't do her homework. So she started figuring out she had married an unbeliever, and that crushed her. She started going to church and trying to pull me into church very gently. And over time, I was willing to go because I just hated the arguments. And we eventually found ourselves in a church that taught the Bible verse by verse. And as I heard the Bible taught verse by verse in the book of Genesis, some reason it dawned on me that this was true, and I never had considered that anything in the Bible was true, much less the flood story. But as I realized that was true, I started asking myself, well, if that's true, well, then all of it's true. What isn't true? And it started making me think very differently about what was in that book and what it said to me. And the man preaching it was preaching the gospel in the course of going through that book. And so as I heard it one day, I realized that's the truth. I've never heard that before. I grew up a Catholic, and I'd never heard the gospel. Now, for the first time, I'm hearing it. And it made sense. And at the time, I just simply heard it as a story that made sense and I would accept it. But after that moment, as God began to talk to me in my heart, I realized that what had happened in that moment was a lot more important than what I took it to mean at the time. That now, all of a sudden, I was a different person. He was not only talking to me about the truth of the Bible, but about the truth of himself and about the need to teach and be ready to teach. And I was scared to death because I didn't know anything about the Bible and I didn't know how I was going to teach it. And in the years that followed, as I sat in church and heard the teaching of the Bible, it began to give me a love for it that I've never had for anything else. And all those other things I wanted to do, suddenly I didn't care about them anymore. It's like those things were never that valuable anyway. Now I really didn't care about them. And I knew what I was supposed to do. And it's like when you find that thing in life God's called you to do that's unique and specific to you, it just clicks. And, I started changing in ways I never anticipated. You start to realize the kind of person you really were when you start looking back on what you've become. You know, the husband that you thought was so good, turns out I was a terrible husband. The father I thought I was so good at being, I wasn't very good at it. And a lot of other things. And the years that have followed since then, not only have I got a purpose and a satisfaction in life, but now I understand I have a destiny in life that's based on a faith in Christ, not in my own works, not in my own effort. Jesus had to step into my life to change that perspective. And when he did it in that year, late 1990s, it moved me on a totally new track. Okay, that's 3 minutes and 30 seconds, so that's a little long for my standard, but...
You cheated too,
because
you looked
up.
You looked down.
One time. Twice. But I didn't change what I was doing.
Yeah.
So, all right, so that's... And I've said it 100 different ways. So it's always going to be around where I came out of school, came through life, you know, all the nonsense I was running after. And then I came to a moment of faith in a church, listening to the Word of God taught, knowing Christ was true because the Word is true, and then moved from that way into something later. It does, you know, a lot of this is sort of artificial, because if I'm talking to one person, there's something about their life I'm trying to connect to. So I'm going to give the story a little differently, you know, and you know, to someone, for example, who sees me as being so, and I don't see this myself, but you might understand me when I say this. Somebody might look at me and say, well, you're so far above where I am. I can't relate to that. Well, okay, I mean, I think that's false anyway. But even if you think that, I tell people, look, you didn't know who I was 10 years ago. You know, when I came to belief in the late 1990s, showed up here in San Antonio in 2001, I looked a lot like I did before I became a believer back then. I mean, I was, you know, selfish, self-absorbed, egotistical. I'm none of those things now, of course. I'm very proud of my humility, I should add, by the way. And that, you know, that's simply to say you don't get there in a day. So, you know, maybe you tailor it for that person, or for the person who is, you know, I'm not going to have a history of drug addiction and all that. So how do I relate to that person? Well, I can simply acknowledge, you know, I can't say I know what you're going through, but I remember a day when I felt lost and when I felt like the world had nothing to offer me and I felt like I had, you know, no hope. You can use general terms. Okay, so we got 15 minutes, right? 2:45, 3:45, is that right? Somebody want to tell me my own conference schedule, because I don't know it.
Okay, I'll go.
You ready to go? Okay, the condition is you got to come up here.
Sure.
Come on up, Kevin.
Can you let me look at the...
No. If I start sweating, you've gone too long.
Okay, you can tap.
No, I'm just kidding. If you want to look, I will let you look.
All right.
Here's the way I would like you to do it, though, if you don't mind. I'd like you to watch the faces of the crowd, and when they start to wane in interest, you've gone too long.
Okay. All right.
Because you will happen. You know, it's funny. They can't tell they're doing it, but it'll happen. They'll start looking at their watch. Okay.
So I connected a lot with you. I grew up in a Christian home. I went to a parochial school when I was young, mm-hmm. Through fourth grade, where I learned the Bible every day. Memorized hymns. It was a denominational church, a Lutheran church. So I knew grace very well. I knew Ephesians 2:8-9, saved by grace through faith, lest any man should boast. And that's pretty much where I stopped. When I got to be 18 years old, I went to college, and I didn't go to church, and I kind of lived my own way, and I continued to do that until I was about 26 years old, and I would say I was probably saved when I was young, but it's kind of hard to tell, you mm-hmm. know? But when I got to be about 26, because of my lifestyle, I got to a point where I had a situation in my life that I couldn't handle. And that was the first time that I got to the point where I say, I give up, and I turn to God. And I told him, take over, because I cannot fix this. I can't see a way out. And I was sitting in my car, and it's a really strange story, but long story short, I felt this peace come over me that was unlike anything, and I felt like everything was going to be okay. My situation didn't change at all, but I felt like it was all going to be okay. And I continued on from there. Mm-hmm. I got married. I had kids. We went to church regularly, but I really didn't progress a whole lot. I look back on that period of time, and I feel like I knew God, but I was in the driver's seat, and he was in the passenger seat. And I still had control. And I really didn't change until I moved to Texas about 12 years ago now, and I got into a Bible study where I was studying the Word of God daily. And talking about spiritual growth, you know, my whole life until I was 40 years old, I could turn back, and it was like flat ground. I did not really see a whole lot of movement. And then when I started studying the Bible daily, it totally changed my life. And now I can look back, and I can see how I have changed over time. And I can look back, and I'm not where I want to be. I'm not, you know, yet perfected, but I do have hope in my life, because I can see tremendous change in myself. From where I was 10 years ago, where I was 5 years ago, where I was 1 year ago. And I've got that same feeling that you have, where I finally latched on to what I was made for. And I don't know what I'm going to do or where I'm going to go, but I feel like God's got control over my life now, and I'm just waiting to see what happens.
Okay.
So that's kind of my story.
So how much time did it take?
Whoa. 2 minutes.
Okay, so he's dead on with time. I got two more volunteers. Is that it or questions? If you're volunteering, hold on. We got enough time to do a quick, and I didn't do this for myself, I just realized, so I need to do that for fairness, and that is a quick critique.
I don't know if I ever said Jesus.
He did not.
You didn't say Jesus. And I would say my own critique was a similar one.
But he was there.
I mean, in recognition of the bravery of those who stand up, we're going to go easy on them. But the point is, I think Kevin's story is, now he, in my opinion, yours is a good example of a story where it's less about the pivot around salvation, more about the pivot around sanctification. Yeah. Perfectly reasonable. I think that's legitimate. And he's acknowledging the Word as the center of his change, which is Jesus. But to the uninitiated, they won't make that connection. Yeah. That's all. But good job. I thought that timing-wise, obviously perfect. A comment before we do another volunteer?
I feel like that was an encouraging...
It was very encouraging.
For me as a Christian.
Mm-hmm. Oh, you know what? Let's talk about that for just half a second. You said it's very encouraging for someone who is a Christian.
Christian.
That's actually another altogether a whole other purpose of testimonies and a very legitimate one.
You know, and I think that's where I spend a great deal of my time because being in the Word of God has changed me so much. That's where my passion is. And so I would say I'm more on the discipleship side than on the evangelistic side.
And that's okay. And I would say in my own walk, verse-by-verse ministry is set up principally as an equipping ministry for believers. We certainly acknowledge that we're going to influence an unbeliever here and there as God appoints, but that's not our focus. We're not a mission-oriented mission or ministry. Having said that, though, we certainly want to equip people to be evangelistic, but I'm like Kevin in that respect. I'm going to probably favor more a ministry to the believer. But I'm glad you brought it up just to acknowledge that fact. You may be called to give a testimony to believers, in which case now your focus should be purposeful for their sake. It's still purposeful. It's just now you're not trying to convert. Now you're trying maybe to stimulate them to good works, stimulate them to advance in their spiritual maturity, or to encourage them against persecution or setbacks or whatever. That's good. No.
Part, it should not.
Remember, you've got a toolbox with a lot of different tools in it. Jesus is the center of every one of those tools. But the content of what the tool does will differ. If you want to know more about what you're talking about, stick around until 4 o'clock, okay? But we're going to do the evangelistic toolbox at 4 in here. By the way, the intent is not that you would just sit here. The intent is that everyone's moving around because there's going to be more people coming in. But if you had an interest in it, you're welcome to stay. I do it again tomorrow as well, by the way. But that one is where we're going to talk about a more, like Romans 6:23, the specific gospel spelled out for someone when that's the right tool. This is a tool for someone who, if you said, hey, friend, let me explain the gospel to you, and you whipped out your New Testament, they'd be like, oh, no, no, no. And for the same reason, when you're giving your testimony, you don't say Jesus was born in the form of man so that he could take the sins of the world on the cross. That's what you're saying to them after they say, tell me more about Jesus.
Yeah. So you get them hooked with this. And then
this is about walking them. I think of it metaphorically on that seesaw. You're walking over to their side and sitting down on the low side of the seesaw with them. And you're saying, you know what? I know how you can get to the other side, because I've been here with you. And let me tell you how I got to the other side. And that what they're hearing is a story of hope that gives them reason to think I can do the same thing. When they're ready to make the trip, okay, now we got to talk about the gospel in a more specific sense.
I would really like to impress, it's come up a little bit, but I would really like to impress the idea the name of Jesus needs to be said. Yes. Because we're living, I'm getting to be one of those people that really thinks we're headed toward the end times closer and closer.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
There are too many people, including good Christians, that never say the name of Jesus.
Right, right. I'm absolutely, right. Yeah, I fully agree with that. And I know for most of us, we have that in the back of our mind. It may not be the word we use, but I think it is important to distinguish what God we're talking about.
Nowadays.
Right. We have time for another? Yes, ma'am. I'll get you one. We're going to do this next two quick, okay? Come on up. We got 5 minutes, and we should be able to get two in 5 minutes.
All right. Okay, first of all, my name is Rosemary, and I could relate to the video context so much, and also the culture that we're living in. I believe in Christ. Jesus Christ saved me when it was a lifestyle, or the culture was all about, a homosexual lifestyle. I was there for 22 years. I've been set free now for 18 years. Glory to God, okay? Because of His grace and mercy. God has helped me go through so many different challenges in my life. And it seems like I can relate to the individuals, the youth, the adults, the parents that have loved ones that are engaged in that lifestyle and don't know where to go, don't know what to do. It's like God has prepared my heart and taken me through those challenges to say, you know what, Rosemary, it's time. It's time to step up and have that boldness to relate to others. So, you know, glory to God for that, because I don't have that strength. God is the one that gives us the strength to go and be the evangelist for those that need to understand, for those to preach to the lost. Not with hate or hatred or anything like that, but with love and compassion. And that's what it's all about. Jesus Christ gives us love and compassion. So let's share that with everybody. Let's do that. But at the same time, have that boldness. And if God has called you into a ministry, then be faithful and obey and just follow his footsteps.
Okay, so hold on right there. That's a minute and a half. So I'm going to use the other minute and a half for some couple questions. So when did you come to faith? Just briefly.
98.
Okay, so the moment of your coming to faith, do you remember that?
Yes, I do.
So that part of the story was missing. And so tell us real quickly how you came to faith.
When I came to faith, I wanted to commit suicide because that day I was going to live in a house with my lover at that point. We bought a home. And I had gotten a phone number of this church that I had passed by through. All of a sudden, I put this phone number in my purse, not knowing if I would ever need this phone number to a church, because I was never involved in church. I grew up as a Catholic, okay? And so that day came where she told me she was going to leave me. She didn't want nothing to do with me. I had a knife in one hand, I had the phone in the other, and I called the church. And I said, okay, all I want right now is to go in and speak to someone. Please don't put me on hold. If you put me on hold, I might not be here. Okay, so that day, I went to the church. They welcomed me with open arms. Never had I experienced that. Went in, spoke with the pastor, told him at the very early age of being abused, being raped at that time, sharing everything, and the burden just came off, and I just felt the Holy Spirit and God just enter into my heart. So that day I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior.
Amen. That's awesome. Thank you very much. All right, so, boy, that story would be powerful for some people, wouldn't it? All right, so great. And the story you were talking to us about as you opened up was the story of almost the good side of that seesaw, but we hadn't heard all the other stuff, and I don't know if it was a bit sensitive and you were a little unsure of whether to bring it up.
I didn't know if I had enough time.
Oh, okay. come on up. So I just want to acknowledge that's a great, you put those two halves together in the opposite order, and that's a perfect testimony. I mean, not perfect in the sense of your life or whatever. I'm saying in the organization of it, lots of power behind that message. So you can see, obviously, how that message to the right person in the right moment could be life-changing, right? Absolutely. Go ahead.
Okay. My name is Sophie. I grew up in a home where I had both my parents married. They were always gone at work, so me and my younger brothers and sisters kind of grew up alone. I was the oldest, so I almost in a way started taking care of them. My mom's in here, so I'm like, so then after that, of course, I started finding my own ways in society and trying to just be accepted towards other people. So I started being a very bad teenager. Started sneaking out, left, became a drug addict, had my daughter at 16, went all over looking for something and just never found it. I was looking mainly in men, relationships, work, anywhere I could get any kind of attention. I was about 21 or 22 and my mom started going to church again. And then, so I went to church with her. I was not a believer at the time at all. And then at some point, I drifted away because I got a boyfriend who was very against God, started doing drugs, started leaving my daughter everywhere. She really didn't have a home, and neither did I. And so one night, God just broke me down, and in the middle of my living room floor, I just got on my knees and started praying and crying to Jesus. I didn't know who he was or anything, but I said, if you're real, I need to be rescued. And ever since then, just small little steps, he had helped me come to him and know him through his word. And I ended up marrying one of my childhood friends who had also went through the same thing I did. And so now here we are with three of our own kids, and Jesus is the only one and the only way that has saved our lives.
Praise the Lord. Amen. So 210, Sue 210, and by the way, shorter's not worse. Shorter's actually better in many ways. 210, and really well, you know, thought through, obviously, the before and after, Jesus pivoting in the middle of it for her. And, you know, certainly if you had listened to that story, now you notice some themes cropping up, right? When people are living in their flesh, they go to the things of the world that the flesh always wants, which is, you know, sex, drugs, rock and roll kind of stuff. And that's so common in the culture that I assure you, friends, even if you don't have that kind of bad girl, bad boy background, you can certainly find elements of it almost in anybody's life before they're a believer, even if it's not to the nth degree. And if you do, you'll identify with people through that. We're at the limit in other sessions. I mean, I'm cutting into your break time right now, okay, just so you know. So let's take a quick comment and then we'll break up.
Yeah, I would love to hear her talk a little bit, like as one or two more sentences about, no, I'm just...
Yeah, right, on what? On what?
On just how, you know, Christ, and you said a little bit about it, but just how Christ has really brought you to a point of
sure
fulfillment or joy or whatever, you know, just to close it
so
out.
Now so if,
beautiful.
Yeah, so I'll end with this. If Sophie had been talking to a neighbor mother with small kids and a husband that was an alcoholic or something, right, she's going to give that woman some hope if they don't already know Jesus, from the standpoint of, look, if he can save us, there's hope for you. And let me explain that. And so, you know, there, I think that's where these are a bit artificial. When you know who you're talking to, you know what aspect of what you're talking about to narrow down to. All right, so I hope what I've done in the short time we had was really give you guys a different way of thinking about this thing. You all have this one, okay? You all have this tool because you all have a testimony. All right, let's end in prayer briefly. Father, thank you, Lord, for our time together, for the chance to hear these wonderful stories of your work in their lives. We know we each have that same opportunity, Father, to talk of you and of your work. Give us the heart to do it, the courage to do it, Father. Give us a purposeful mindset, too. Let us work hard to be ready for the moment when someone asks us to give a defense for the hope that you've created in each of us. We pray this in Jesus' name.